You know, I like the story about the couple that they're in a restaurant, and the lady looks over and sees another couple at a booth, a couple tables down. Sees the husband real close to the wife and has his arm around her and is whispering things in her ears, and she's giggling, and then he strokes her hair and strokes her shoulder, and the wife looks and says, "Look at them. Look at that over there. That is so incredible. Why can't you ever do that?" And the husband looks up from his appetizer and said, "Honey, I don't even know that woman." There's a man by the name of Willard Harley that several years ago wrote a best-selling Christian book called His Needs, Her Needs. And for the research for this book, he took a survey of over 10,000 married men and 10,000 married women to see what are the biggest needs of a married man and a married woman. And he came up with a list. And something that may not be a surprise to you is that there is not one thing that's on the top five of the man's list that's on the women's list, and not one thing on the women's list that's on the men's list. I mean, God, in His infinite wisdom and in His incredible sense of humor, made us really, really, really different, didn't He? And so, we take a look at these lists, that you're going to realize is that this doesn't apply to every person. This is a generalization, right? So there's people that this list isn't applicable to. But for most people, this really is. And most women, married women, would fall into this. Most married men would fall into the category that we're going to look at another time. Today, in honor of Mother's Day, we're going to look at the list of the five biggest needs of a married woman and women. And came on Father's Day, we're going to do the same thing for the guys. And so, and something too, there's the tagline that says this: building an affair-proof marriage is the part of that book. In other words, this was written mostly for married couples and things. And the thought is this: if we fulfill the biggest needs of our spouse, the chances are a whole lot better that there's not going to be affair, because the needs are already met in the home. So the fact that this is applicable to married couples, that hits about 50% of the people in our church. But for the others, that there's going to be many that are going to someday be married or married again, so that's applicable again. But even for all of us, as we take a look at this, we're in a study in a series on relationships. And this is going to help us to understand the opposite sex even better, whether that be our spouse, whether that be our parents, whether that be our siblings, or whether that just is somebody that we go to school with or work with. It's going to help us understand. So with no further ado, the number one need of a married woman, according to His Needs, Her Needs, is affection. He says this. He says that affection is to a woman what gasoline is to an engine. That one of the greatest needs of a woman is to feel prized, is to feel important. And one of the biggest ways that she will do that is through affection that is shown in different ways. And different ladies understand and receive affection in different ways. For some, it's verbal affection that's the most important. For others, it's gifts and flowers and cards and things like that. For others, it is physical affection, like holding hands and hugs and kisses. In fact, I do like the story too, that the man took his wife to a doctor because she just seemed listless, and the doctor went through a battery of tests and said, "There's nothing physically wrong with your wife." And the man said, "Well, there's something wrong. She's depressed. She's just down. Is there anything you can recommend?" And the doctor thought for a second. He got up from his seat and said, "Yeah, I know. I know what she needs." And he goes over and he gives her a big hug, and then he gives her a kiss right on the lips. And he said, "That's what she needs 3 times a week. And the man said, "I can get her here on Tuesdays and Thursdays, but Saturdays..." The affection your wife needs is from you and not anybody else. Affection for a man, usually, most men, it comes harder, more difficult than affection for the ladies. But when has that stopped us before, guys? Just because something doesn't seem as natural to us has never stopped us before. It's not natural for me to go to meetings, but we do the things. In fact, how about this? For most guys, golf is not a natural sport. I mean, football is more natural, hunting, something like that. Just give us something to tackle, give us something to shoot, something like that is a more natural sport. But to hit a little bitty ball without hitting the big ball and hit it in a straight line, that comes unnatural for most guys. But that doesn't stop guys from trying to do that. They'll go out and they will practice. They will go to driving ranges. They will take lessons. They will, even though they mess up again and again and again, they keep going out there. You know why? Because the desire is there. And the same thing for us as guys, that some guys may not be affectionate, but if the desire is there, you are going to try to be affectionate for your wife because it is so important for her. And somebody may say this, well, you know, affection doesn't really come that easy for me, that I'm not the affectionate type. Well, I bet you were the affectionate type, or that beautiful lady probably would not have married you because affection is that important. And so what it means is become affectionate again, to once again discover affection in our life, or if you've never done that, to discover it. And like anything else, it may be awkward at first, but as you do it more, it will become more natural, just like something like golf or something like anything else that may be awkward at first. And here's something too, is to have no ulterior motives when we show affection. Ed Young says this in Romancing the Home. He says, there's not a woman alive who doesn't know the difference between affection, period, and affection, comma. The affection that satisfies a wife's desire has no strings attached. A hug is a hug, not a prelude to sex or an announcement that he just bought a boat. The husband that only touches his wife as an entree to lovemaking needs to understand that he's depriving her of something that's as important to her as sex is to him. And she is loved and appreciated, period. And there are some guys that maybe say, man, I'm at a loss. I don't know what she would want and what affection would be important to my wife. Ask her. She's the All-American. She's the Heisman Trophy winner. She's summa cum laude when it comes to knowing how best she understands and feels affection. So ask her and the mystery will be solved. So the first thing is affection. The second one is meaningful conversation. Let's go ahead and show these things up there. What do these three things have in common with each other? The button, stapler, and a paperclip. They're all designed, they are created to connect, right? And ladies are created by God Almighty to connect, and they're awesome at it. Whether it means to connect with their children or connect with their friends. But most of all, God created them to connect with us. In fact, the Bible says this in Genesis chapter 2, for this reason, a man shall leave his mother and father and be united to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. And the word there for united is this. It means in the original language, it means to connect, to cling to hold to keep close. And God's talking about way more than just sexual intimacy when he talks about unity there. He's talking about physical, spiritual, and emotional in all its ways. And here's the thing, that not only are women incredible at connecting, they're also incredible at communication. They were made to communicate, and they're great at it. Some fun statistics, okay, that you may not be aware of. The difference between a baby boy and a baby girl. A baby girl moves her lips 200 times more than a baby boy. A preschool girl, nearly 100% of everything that sounds that she makes are word related. Only 68% of that which the little boys do are word related. The others are sounds of a car or a bomb or a gun or a plane or a dinosaur or bodily functions or anything like that, right? Something else is women. The average woman speaks 25,000 words a day. The average guy speaks 12,200 words a day. That's why, guys, when you come home and all of a sudden you've already given your allotted words for the day, she's already only halfway down the pike, right? And wouldn't it sometimes help if there was a sign out front, a tote board that as you drove up to the there that said, I got 11,330 more words to share. And something too is that, but time out, because something that you may not know is the words that we say are as important to us. We may not say as many, but they're just as important as your words to you. In fact, somebody said this, a female counselor said, men may speak only 12,000 words a day and women 25,000, but men want to be heard in the 12,000 words they do say. And if and here's something to understand. If you do all the talking, that's not a conversation. That's a monologue. And don't be surprised if the guy shuts down after a while because what he hears is his words are not all that important. But here's the one thing that guys have to do. We have to listen to her. And again, the problem is that guys are not sometimes as good of listeners as the ladies are. Ladies are natural amplifiers. And what that means is they will take the problem, they will take the information, and they will amplify. And what that means is they will look at it from 1,000 different directions. Guys are different. We are natural condensers. We will take all the information and we will boil it down to, okay, what do we do? What do we do about it? The lady will say, here's the information, let's discuss it. The man will say, here's the information, let's deal with it. And maybe here's a fun way of looking at that.
It's just, there's all this pressure, you know? And sometimes it feels like it's right up on me and I can just feel it, like literally feel it in my head, and it's relentless. And I don't know if it's gonna stop. I mean, that's the thing that scares me the most, is that I don't know if it's ever gonna stop.
Yeah. Well, you do have a nail in your head.
It is not about the nail.
Are you sure? Because, I mean, I'll bet if we got that out of there.
Stop trying to fix it.
No, I'm not trying to fix it. I'm just pointing out that maybe the nail is causing—
You always do this. You always try to fix things when what I really need is for you to just listen. No,
see, I don't think that is what you need. I think what you need is to get the nail
out. See, you're not even listening now.
Okay, fine. I will listen. Fine.
It's just, sometimes it's like, there's this achy, I don't know what it is. And I'm not sleeping very well at all. And all my sweaters are snagged. I mean, all of them.
That sounds really hard.
It is. Thank you. Ow! Oh,
come on, ow. If you would just—
Don't!
Try to see things my way. Do I have to keep on talking till I can go on? We can work it out. We can work it out.
Difference between being listened to and being fixed. And sometimes ladies just want to be listened to, and other times, guys, we have the tendency just to fix when that's not what is needed at the moment. The other thing is to listen with more than just the words. Listen to the heart of what is trying to be said. An example of that would be this. Maybe you come home and say, hey, how you doing, honey? And she says that, I guess I'm okay. I'm a little discouraged. Now, what we would have a tendency to say, she's okay, right? But what's the real message there? I'm a little discouraged, and be able to listen more than just the words. But also, ladies, you have to understand, this is real important. Guys can't read your minds, right? That you'd like us to. You'd love us to. You'd hope we could. You'd hope, especially the more we knew you, you could read your minds. But maybe your lady friends can understand that and decode it more. We can't. So if you want to get through to a guy, be clear with that of what your feelings are, what your needs are. Another thing is give her eye contact. That women, if you've ever noticed this, men and women communicate completely different. If you see guys at a coffee shop, if you see guys, they will almost always talk completely different from a lady. A lady at a coffee shop, they'll be looking at each other, they'll be drinking the coffee off, and almost never lose eye contact with each other. That's why a little girl will say these words, okay? A little girl will look at her dad and say, look at me, Dad. Look at me, Dad, while she's talking, right? You almost never hear a little boy say those same words. A guy doesn't speak eye to eye as much, two guys together. They speak shoulder to shoulder, right? A guy will speak shoulder to shoulder with another guy. That's why ball games are so good for us, because we can talk like this, but every once in a while we just look over and make sure the guy hasn't run away or anything like this. We can do a completely different way, not one way right, one way wrong. We are different, and viva la difference that God made us. Another thing is be understanding. Be understanding. Now, for a lot of guys, when we hear the words understand and women, those are two words that don't go together in our mind a lot. It's kind of like the guy who was walking along the coastline and came across a bottle. So he rubbed the bottle, and sure enough, a genie comes out of the bottle. And he said, and the genie said, "You may have one wish." And he said, "Really? Okay. Well, here's what I'd like. I've always wanted to go to Hawaii, but I'm scared to fly, and I'm scared of a boat. So I would like you to make a highway to Hawaii." And the genie goes, "Come on, that's ridiculous. I mean, think about all that would take. Think of everything, the obstruction that would be and everything. Isn't there anything else you would like?" And the man said, "All right, well, I would love to know to be able to understand women." And the genie looked and said, "You want that highway 2 lanes or 4 lanes? And stuff, but it doesn't mean that we understand. It means that we stand under, is really what the word means. We may never understand, but to stand under, and the word to stand under, it means that we support, that we hold, that we encourage, that we do that. That's what it means to understand. Galatians 6:2 says, bear one another's burden and so fulfill the law of Christ. The other thing is openness and honesty. And I think a deck of cards is a great way to understand this, with the difference between guys and girls. Ladies like this. Ladies like all the cards on the table, everything out in the open. And guys seem to play things a little closer to the chest, right? And so, you know, I feel like I'm supposed to say this. I don't know why. Maybe that's some reason that it seems like ladies get the God thing a whole lot easier than guys sometimes. And maybe because everything's out in the open, maybe sometimes, guys, we got to stop doing this with our God, and we got to stop doing this with our ladies. Because with God, we can be open, and we can do that same thing with our ladies as well. For, again, we're totally created different, and it's pretty amazing how we're created different in this way. Women are like super Walmarts. And in a super Walmart, everything's under one roof, right? It's incredible. Think about this. You've got clothing next to food, next to tires, next to electronics, next to plants, next to toys, next to sporting goods. It's all under one roof, and that's how a lady operates, because her emotions, her feelings, and her intellect is all under one canopy. For guys, it's different. Guys are more like the Concord Mills. Because there's different stores, but you got to go out of one store, go and turn to go into another store. And guys have their rooms, right? Guys have their job room. Guys have their sports room. Guys have their relationship room. Guys have their wife room. God has their children room. God have their hobby room. Whatever it is, and we go in and out. That's why a guy can be watching football and be totally unaware that the dog's on fire, right? Because they're in a different room. And sometimes, I have to say this to Sylvia, sometimes I will, that I'll be in a room and I'll realize that she was just said something, and I'll go, "Wait, honey, say that again. I didn't hear that because I was in a room." We have that clue of saying, "I was in a room, sorry about that, what did you say?" To be able to clue in back with that, because we go in and out of rooms. In fact, guys have a room called the nothing room. If you ask a guy, "What are you thinking of?" he says nothing, and he means it, right? He can say nothing. In fact, sometimes it's our favorite room to go into, especially if we've had a long day. Sometimes we just need to be in our nothing room for a couple minutes to get the act together again. Now, let's look at it another way. That I've seen two different types of Christmas lights in my lifetime. One is you can have 100 lights, and one of them breaks, right? One of them goes in shorts, and what happens to all of it? Every one of them are down, right? It affects every single light. There's other lights that I've had that you have 100 of them, and 50 of them are down, the other 50 work, right? And women are more like the first one, that if something happens, if they're discouraged, if they're frustrated, if they're hurt, it affects every part of life, right? And guys are more like the compartmentalized, that boom, something can happen here, but it doesn't affect over here. That's why a guy can have a fight with his wife and still expect sex over here. And that's because it's two different rooms. You got the friendship room and you got the sex room, and they don't compete with each other. Well, this baffles the mind of women because they're going, how do you do that? How do you do that? That she has to be reconciled in order to go into bed because everything's under one roof. And the Bible says this, that just in openness, open to me, my darling, my treasure, my lovely dove, that we are open with each other. That's what hits a woman's heart. But also not only openness, but also honesty. That honesty is like the cranes that you see in downtown Charlotte that are building things, and one part at a time, one beam at a time, one floor at a time, one story at a time. All that. Every time we are honest, it builds the relationship. Every time we have an opportunity to say a lie or tell the truth, even if it hurts, that it builds that relationship and builds that trust and builds that security for the lady. But every time we would tell a lie, anytime we would tell a lie, it is like a wrecking ball that comes in and hurts and destroys the security and the relationship. We need to realize that it is that important. It's really important to God, too. Listen to this. That there's, I don't know if you know this, but there's things that God hates. And God mentioned some of them right here in a list. There are six things that the Lord hates. This is from Proverbs 6. Seven things that are detestable, pretty strong word to him. Haughty eyes, which is pride. A lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked schemes, feet that are quick to rush to evil. Here's another, a false witness who pours out lies, and a person who stirs up conflict in the community. Two of the seven deal with honesty. And there are really three types of liars in the world. There is the number one, the born liar. This is I guess we're all born liars to one degree or another, because there's the time that, you know, when we are a child, you don't have to teach a child to lie, do you? A child just, you know, immediately comes out and you say, were you in the cookie jar? Crumbs everywhere, right? No, I wasn't in there. But you didn't have to teach him or her to lie. But there's some people, hopefully, that most people will outgrow that, especially if we're a child of God, going, I'm going to become an honest person. I'm not going to lie anymore. But there are other people that they've not only keep doing that, but they have perfected lying, right? That is who they are. That is what they do. That will always go, their whole life is a lie. Their native language is a lie. I've known people like that. You've known people like that. But there's also the don't rock the boat liar. This is somebody who just doesn't lie all the time, but if they're about to get in trouble, they will lie. Did you pay the bill? Did you get the babysitter? Yes, I did that. And to save trouble at the moment, there will be more trouble to pay down here. And that's, you don't want to rock the boat, but it's like either pay me now a little now or pay me later over here. The other liar is the protection liar. This person has a good reason to do that. They truly want to protect the other person's feelings, emotions, and pain. They don't want them to go through pain if they can spare them from that. I'd be maybe that they're about to lose their job, or there's a financial issue or a health issue that's going on, and the person is thinking that I don't want to. There's no sense in all of us hurting and both of us hurting. I'll just try to carry this weight alone. But the problem is that hurts the lady because of this, because she wants to be part of the solution with you, and it hurts her that you didn't trust her enough and her reaction enough to share that with her. So, and there's a time that's lying is telling an untruth, but sometimes a form of lying is also withholding information that we could share as well. The Bible says this, therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his or her neighbor. Colossians 3:9 says, do not lie to one another, since you have taken off your old self with its practices. God takes complete truth completely seriously. So do our wives, and so should we as men as well. The fourth thing is financial support. This one should be fairly self-explanatory. A wife needs to know that she is going to be taken care of, her needs are going to be met, and the needs of your children are going to be met as well. The fifth one is family commitment. A woman needs to know that her husband will be a good father and a good family man. And part of a woman's security is this. Part of a woman's security is to know that right after your commitment to God, the next two most important commitments of your life are first and foremost to her, and secondly to your children. Guys, let me just be real honest and real blunt right here. Most things that you do, other people could do. Most things. But there are three things that only you can do that no other person can do in your life. The first one is your relationship with God. No one else can worship God for you. No one else can express that. No one else can. Your mama can't, your dad can't, your pastor can't, your wife can't, anything. Only you can worship God for you. The other thing is this. Only you can be a husband to your wife. No one else on the planet. And only you can be a dad to your children. Again, no one else can take that place. But Ed Young puts it like this. Husbands and fathers should know that when they stand before God Almighty, He will make them account for the kind of family that they have made. He will not ask the wife's sister or best friend if she did all she could do to make the wife the woman of God that God called her to be. He will ask her husband. He will not call the babysitter, the daycare director, or the school teacher to inquire whether they nurtured and cared for and encouraged his children. He will ask their father. Men are accountable for loving their wives and caring for their children. No one else is. No one else. And if you're like the rest of us, there's things as we look at this and we fall short on every single one of these, but there's a difference between knowing we fall short and saying, well, that's the way things go. That what our call is as men, our call as husbands, is to do everything we can to meet the needs of our wives. And they may not fit directly on this, but to find out what those needs are and to do that. And here's again, affection. Showing her affection in a way that she understands. Meaningful communication. That means to listen, and to listen with more than the words, and to look, to give her your attention, to be understanding, to stand up under, to encourage, to support. Openness and honesty. The cards on the table, and always complete truth. Financial support and family commitment. And we will never fulfill all those needs. Only God can fulfill the emotional needs of a woman. But what our job is, guys, is to do everything we can to encourage, to support, to meet the needs of the precious heart of the wives God gave us. Amen.